They are going. Okay, so we are going to be covering Genesis 26. We are covering Genesis 26, and the focus is on Isaac. And we are going to be looking at Isaac the sower. So we're looking at economy and how Isaac prospered. You know. So we're going to be sharing Bible verses to read, number one. Number two, I'm going to be leaving intentional questions and leaving it blank and open for people to speak. Please don't let that the silence be very awkward and long. Please contribute. Please contribute. And also trust the Spirit of God inside of you. There's something you have to say. There's something. Oh, is Brother Fulu? Sorry, I said presumption. Thank you, Brother Fulu. Forgive me. Okay, so we're going to start. So we're going to be looking at the story of Isaac, and we'll be focusing on certain parts of his life, especially how he got, how God blessed him, how God blessed him economically. You know, how he went to from 0 to 100 very real quick. You know, how God expanded him. And we're going to be looking at principles we could apply. Obviously, the only person that's perfect in the Bible is Jesus. You know, although we are called to that perfection now, but the only person that we can really say that everything he did was without fault, without flaws, is Jesus. So we've seen some of Isaac's flaws, but we'll also be seeing some of his wins. And trust me, there are many. He's part of the heroes of faith, and he obtained a good testimony by the way he lived his life. So I think there are a lot of things for us to learn from Isaac in Genesis chapter 26. So first of all, we're going to start with prayer. So he's going to open us up with prayer, please. Who wants to start? Please, if you want to open us up with prayer, you can unmute your mic and
start. I can do it.
Oh, thank you very much, Sister Wayne.
Good evening, Father. Thank you for just this opportunity to spend time with you, to glean in on your word. Holy Spirit, we ask that you teach us your word. You reveal the truth to us in your word, and you help every seed that is sown, every word, to grow root in our hearts. Help our hearts to be good soil so that when the seeds are planted, it harvests multiple fold. I pray that you just give us also the boldness to speak, that we will not be shy, and that you help us to interact in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that. What you said, Odikwa, very important. That we will not be shy. Shyness, get out of the door in the mighty name of Jesus. So I'm going to be starting from Genesis chapter 26. I'll start with who can volunteer to do the Bible reading. We can open our Bibles to Genesis chapter 26. I'll need someone to start with from verse 1. So the way we're going to do it is we're going to take 5 verses. We'll stop, we'll talk about it, what we learned, and everybody contribute before we move on to the next 5. So we'll have a different reader for every 5 verses, basically. So did we all get that? So for the first 5 verses, please, who wants to volunteer? Keeps getting connected. Or should I choose someone? Class captain. Okay. Who's there?
Okay, I will go. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Oh, okay. He says that now there was a famine in the land beside the earlier famine of Abraham's time. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, please, I cannot pronounce that one. It will break my teeth. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you and will bless you. For to you and your descendants, I will give all this land. I will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and will give them all this land. And through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed. 5 says that, because Abraham obeyed me and kept my requirement, my commands, my decrees, and my laws.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you so much, Sister Amaka. So this is awesome. So I'm just going to start with some things I picked up from here before I leave the floor open to us. So you guys will know I've read the scripture, because you know the way you do it in class is, in case you have not prepared, you just give everyone as assignment and just sit back as the moderator. So just to prove to you guys that I read it, I'm going to say what I learned from the scripture, then also to leave the floor open to some of us, basically, or to all of us, basically. And please, all of us, all the quiet, but all of us, so we can say what we like. Firstly, when we look at verse 1, it says there was famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. Now, this is very, very critical because the writers of the Bible are very intentional in every word they put in the Bible. Every remark has significance. So if they are telling, if they are referring, they could just have said there was famine in the land. But they are trying to compare this famine that this famine is similar to the famine that happened in the days of Abraham. So you're going to be saying that, so we are going to see that Isaac is put in a similar circumstance that Abraham had lived through. And so we see that comparison. And through this chapter of 26, you're going to be seeing a lot of comparisons, or you're going to be seeing some things, especially similarities, both similarities and differences between what Isaac did in that situation and what Abraham did in that situation. So basically, that's the first thing I noted. There was comparison between those two scenarios. And the Bible is saying that Isaac went to Abimelech, the king of Philistines in Gerar, which is very important. Then verse 2, then the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt to live. Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land which I shall tell you. Dwell in this land, and I'll be with you and bless you. For to you and your descendants, I'll give you this land, and I'll perform the oath which I swore to Abraham your father. Now, that verse 2 is very important to me, because it shows you that Isaac was going to Egypt. That's why God had to tell him, do not go to Egypt. That means in his heart, there was an intention in his heart to journey into Egypt. Because if you read Genesis 12, so if you guys want to check the similarity where Abraham encountered that same thing, you go back to Genesis 12. If you read Genesis 12, the Bible says that Abraham, because of the famine, went down into Egypt. Like, he went down to Egypt direct, you know, because of the famine, you know. So Isaac, I'm sure, was like, man, copy and paste. My father went to Egypt during his days. I'm going to go to Egypt, you know. But luckily for him, God intercepted him, and God directed him to stay in the land of Gerar. Prior to this, Isaac was living in a land called Beer Lahairoi, which means well to the living one who sees me. Now, but the similarity I see here is that Isaac does not repeat what I'll call the mistake of his father Abraham. We all know that if you read Genesis chapter 12 very critically, you know that what drove Abraham to the land of Egypt was basically hunger. It was famine. Abraham usually in Genesis 12, in his days, usually sought the Lord. You see him get to a place, pray and seek God before he makes his next move. But the move to Egypt, there was no praying, no seeking the Lord mentioned in that verse. It was straight down to Egypt. And although his journey was blessed with a lot of prosperity, you know, he got there, he was rich and all that, we realize that when he left Egypt, a seed has been sown. Because one of the issues that Abraham is going to have will be with a servant girl from Egypt named Hagar. But Isaac doesn't repeat the same mistake. You know, he obeys the Lord. That's the way I see it, basically. He obeys the Lord, and he chooses to dwell in the land which God tells him to dwell. And one thing I see God doing is that, you know, Abraham is dead. And, you know, this is a situation where if it's a normal man, like I made a promise to you, now you're dead. Maybe there's no one to remind your son, so I can easily slip out of that covenant. I can easily slip out of that promise. But we see God's intentionality to bless Isaac. We see that God doesn't want to run away from this oath. God is so eager to perform it. And we see God reiterating this promise to Isaac. And he's saying that he's reiterating it because of his father, Abraham, which brings me to something. Someone said something. He said, our actions may be, how do you say it? He said, our actions may be private, but no action is ever personal. He said, some actions can be private, but no action is either personal. And what he was just trying to say is that actions have a ripple effect on us, and not only on us, but on those around us. So we can see that Isaac's obedience is already giving, like, Abraham's obedience is giving, like, is giving Isaac a very good platform to start his life on. Like, it's just like, man, in a relay race, like, the person that is handing you the baton, like, the distance between you and the guys behind you, like, you are well ahead. So, like, Abraham is like a platform that has jacked Isaac to a place of prime advantage, you know, to start his journey with, you know, which is with the promise of God. And we see that Abraham's obedience, although it was private at the time sometimes, but it's not personal. It has an effect on his generation. So I'm going to pause here, and I'm going to leave the floor open to anyone that wants to contribute. And this is the long, awkward silence that I was trying to avoid. Should we call names? Oh, wait, let me first. Can everyone hear me, please? Let's start on there.
Yes, we can.
You can. I didn't say, maybe before says the guy, and I say, but does anyone have anything to contribute? With this first term, with this first five verses. Loud and clear, okay. Very good. So, Sister Abosede Akinaya says, I feel Abraham's testimony of obedience helped and encouraged Isaac, and he followed suit. Awesome. Okay, anyone else? Okay, Elizabeth, are you sure you don't have anything to say about this verse? Do you have anything to say? Elizabeth Phillips? Not yet, okay. We see God's covenant as work as well. Awesome, that's very, very true. That God's covenant has now, but do you want to explain that? How do we see God's covenant as work, please? So I don't just assume, or nobody just assumes. That's Sister Wumi.
Is it okay to speak, or is it better to type?
Yeah, very okay. It's encouraged both speaking and typing. I prefer speaking, actually.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So it's specifically looking at the verses 4, or we can even start with 3-5. God there says that, I hereby confirm that I will give all this land to you and your descendants, just as I solemnly promised Abraham. Like, he goes to essentially this Abraham in Genesis 12. We can see that the whole God is holding on to that covenant. Not just only to Isaac, we also, you know, even see that in the book of Kings, that his covenant to David he kept, even though people were disobedient. So at work to future descendants of Abraham.
Awesome. You know, there's, I think in Timothy, I'm trying to get the exact verse. It talks about even if we are unfaithful, God still remains faithful. And if we deny him, he can't even deny himself. Like, that's just awesome. Like, God being intentional that he can't deny himself. You know, the Bible says that he found no, when he was making that promise to Abraham, there was no more greater that he could swear by, he had to swear by himself. So God is faithful. Sister Bosede says, I also think God found in Isaac a heart and depth willing to carry on his covenant with Abraham. God's covenant was going to be fulfilled, but through a willing man, through a willing man. May God always find us willing in the mighty name of Jesus. If we are willing and obedient, we will surely eat the good of the land. If we are unfaithful, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. Thank you so much for that scripture. So we're going to be going on to the next five verses. I'm going to start from verse 6 to 11. So can we have a second reader that can read Genesis 26 from 6 to 11 while we look at that, please?
I can read. So Isaac stayed in Gerar. I don't know if that's how you pronounce it. When the men who lived there asked Isaac about his wife, Rebekah, he said, "She's my sister." He was afraid to say she's my wife. He thought, "They will kill me to get her because she is so beautiful." But sometime later, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked out his window and saw Isaac caressing Rebekah. Immediately, Abimelech called for Isaac and exclaimed, "She is obviously your wife. Why did you say she's my sister?" "Because I was afraid someone would kill me to get her from me," Isaac replied. "How could you do this to us?" Abimelech exclaimed. "One of my people might easily have taken your wife and slept with her, and you would have made us guilty of great sin."
Read 11, please.
Then Abimelech issued a public proclamation. "Anyone who touches this man or his wife will be put to death."
Wow. Okay. I see Isaac starting on a similar note his father started on, which is telling lies. And I think the lie started very small with Abraham, because actually Sarah was his sister. You know, it wasn't really a lie like that for Abraham, because, you know, even, and coincidentally, still the same king Abimelech that this thing happened to in Genesis chapter 20, you know, it wasn't really like Sarah was actually Abraham's sister, you know. But now, like, clearly, Isaac has started, the lie has increased with Isaac. And by the time he gets to Jacob, it's like, so we can see the inroot of sin. We can see how generational disobedience is also introduced, or generational characteristics, which are not palatable, is actually introduced to a generation where Abraham lied, just a little white lie, because Sarah was actually his sister. Now, Isaac is doing the same thing. This one is even clear. Maybe it's a gray lie. And before you know it, when he gets to Jacob, we see that pattern continuing. But why does he lie? That's one thing we need to look at. You know, behind every action, I think usually, for example, the Bible talks about the fruits of the Spirit. Now, when we talk about the fruits of the Spirit, fruits are evidence of something that's inside of a tree, which has roots and has its own system. And what you see are actions. Those fruits of the Spirit are actions. So this lie that we are seeing is connected also to a tree. Sometimes we look at, so someone has malaria, the symptoms of malaria is high fever, headache and everything. Sometimes we are so focused on the symptoms that we don't see the tree or the root cause. So, where did he lie? It's not good to lie now. Everybody knows that. But what's the root cause of his lie? The root cause of his lie is fear, basically. The only reason, and that happens to us sometimes, you know, not everybody lies because of fear, but a lot of people lie because they're afraid. And basically, he was afraid. He was not in a place of faith. He didn't believe at that moment that God could protect him. You know, he had faith in other areas where he had seen God work, probably, but in this particular area, I was afraid. And the Bible says something about fear. It says that the snare of man is a snare. You know, so this fear is a root, is the root cause, you know, which the root of that fear is the tree of unbelief also, because he's afraid, because he doesn't believe God will protect him in this situation. So the fruit now that we see is the lies that he tells, you know, basically. Another thing that intrigues me, a side note, is that, man, like, I don't know how beautiful Rebecca was that they're going to kill her. And I don't know how beautiful Sarah was that at 99, like, a king still wanted, like, man, that beauty must have been epic, you know. But we see that coincidentally, God also, even in Isaac's unfaithfulness, God remains faithful. I think this is very key to note. Even in Isaac's unfaithfulness, God remains faithful. Even in Isaac's unfaithfulness, God remains faithful. This is very, very key. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:18 is that it says, as we behold him, we become him. We see that Isaac is lying because of fear, and the fear is rooted in unbelief. So how will Isaac stop lying? The only way Isaac can stop lying is by beholding the consistent nature of God's faithfulness. Because Isaac needs to see the faithfulness of God consistently. That would remove the seed of lies in him. How would I explain this? Because the Bible tells us in Hebrews, I think chapter 11, that God by faith created the world. So God uses faith, you know. Thank you very much for that. Fear triggers doubt, which moves us to displease God, you know. So we see Isaac here clearly that although he's unfaithful, the faithfulness of God is a message to him, to teach him to rely on God's faithfulness. You know, the Bible says something, it says it's the goodness of God that God uses his goodness to lead us to repentance. One of the reasons why God still remains faithful in our unfaithfulness is to teach us faithfulness. You know, a lot of people say some things, you know, and sometimes it can sound religious, but it's actually not scriptural. That, okay, you got yourself into this disobedience, so you need to sort it out yourself. Or, man, since you entered it, you suffer the consequences of what you entered and everything. But that's not scriptural. We see consistently through scriptures that despite Abraham's failings, and despite Isaac's failings, that God's response to their failure is by showing them a higher degree of faithfulness. And this is very, very important. God's response to their unfaithfulness is by showing them a higher degree of faithfulness to teach them how to be faithful. You know, the Bible says in the Psalms 105, it says that he suffered no man to do them wrong. He rebuked kings for their sake, saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophet no harm. Who did he do this for? Basically, it's talking about Abraham. It's talking about Isaac, that even though they lied, like Abraham lied about Sarah and she was there in the house of Abimelech, God was like, no, Abimelech, you can't touch this lady. And, you know, he rebuked the king of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt for a second, he rebuked the king of Egypt, and he rebuked the Philistine king for, you know, basically just to show that he's faithful, basically. So I think that will teach us to rest and rely more on God. You know, the Bible says Yahweh is a teacher in the book of Job. Who teaches like him? One of the things we need to know is this. God is a father that is far, far better than our heavenly fathers. And when we fail an exam or fail a test, sometimes our earthly fathers can be angry at us or mad at us. But what do some good fathers do? They get us lesson teachers. They make sure we study more. They teach us more. How much more a far better father, who is our Heavenly Father, you know? And obviously we see how God steps in and protects Isaac. So I'm going to leave the floor open again for contributions. I've been seeing some, I'm going to read them out. But if there are any contributions, please feel free to speak up. Feel free. So Sister Abosede says this. I think the acts of the people also must have caused the lie. Maybe the people of the land are known for their immoralities and wickedness, but Isaac should have trusted God. Very, very true. Very true. Even when Abraham was going into the land, he said that I know these people, that he presumed they didn't have the fear of the Lord here, you know. But they so very, very true. But any other contribution, please?
I see the mercy of God displayed like in those six chapters. I'm not really sure the number of chapters we read, even going back to, you know, Abraham, I think that was even Genesis 12 and 13 when he deceived Pharaoh as well. And I just, you know, because I don't want to presume, but I think this might have been Isaac's first time, like, really journeying alone with the Lord. He left, you know, to go to Gerar. And thinking about us, like, or just me and my journey with the Lord, it's those beginning journeys can be hard, but as we grow in our relationship with Him, right? The trust, I honestly, I think it's all trust. It's like, I'm in a new place. I know God has said He will be with me, but I don't know. So let me just lie to protect myself, to ensure that nothing happens to Rebecca or myself. So He goes ahead and lies, which trust and faith go hand in hand, right? But that's also what Abraham did. But all in all, it's just God's mercy and grace where, one, Abimelech found out, but also just the mercy of God that Isaac was, there was no sin that was caused, you know what I mean, through the whole lie. So I just see, honestly, God's mercy and kindness in all of the stories, yeah.
I think that's very, very important. Thank you for that. That's God's mercy and kindness. And what you said about Isaac learning, because I think we grow from faith to faith, because Isaac started out, like, it's hard when Isaac tried, you know, he was meant to go to Gerar. He wanted to go to Egypt, but God told him to go to Gerar. So he stayed because there was a level of faith he had, you know, and he's starting his journey and he slipped up, you know, he lied, you know, but God still came through for him, you know. There's one scripture that particularly gets to me. It's in the Psalms. It says, even when my feet slips, mercy will keep me. Even when my feet slips, mercy will keep me. Another one that gets to me is Psalm 23. It says, He leads me in the path of righteousness for His own name's sake. So the reason why God leads me in the path of righteousness is not because, it's not primarily because, it's because of the integrity of Himself. So He ensures that I walk in the path of righteousness. So I think that gets to me. And God's mercy is intentionality to ensure that we succeed. God is not the one with the gavel looking, or with the baton looking to hit our head. He's the helper. He's the one that is rooting for us. He's the one that is cheering for us. He's the one that is ever eager to forgive us even when we sin. You know, another part that gets to me says that there's joy in heaven over when one sinner repents, than 99 people who are righteous. So we see that God is more ecstatic when we come to repentance God is more eager to help us than we are even willing to receive help. So thank you so much for that. That was amazing. Elizabeth Phillips, even in our unfaithfulness, God is still faithful. After Abimelech found out the truth about Isaac and Rebekah, he could have brought an end to their lives, but God showed up. Very true. And God already sees who we truly are, who he created us to be. He knows who we will be, but it's a journey to get there, and he is long-suffering. E.g., Gideon, mighty man of valor, David, etc., long-suffering. He knows who we truly are. Like, sometimes we get tired of ourselves, but God is not tired of us. So we're going to be increasing the pace a little bit. So we're going to be going to verse 12. I will read that, but once I read that, I'm going to leave the floor open for us to speak. I won't speak on that verse first. I'll just read to hear what we have to say on the verse. Then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous, for he had possessions of flocks and possession of herds and great number of servants. So the Philistines envied him. Now the Philistines had stopped the well, which his father's servants had dug in the days of Abraham, his father, and they had filled them with earth. And Abimelech said to Isaac, "Go away from us, for you are much mightier than we." Then Isaac departed from there and pitched his tent in the valley of Gera and dwelt there. So let me just add verse 18. And Isaac dug again the wells of water, which they had dug in the days of Abraham, his father, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He called them the names which his father called them. So I've read from verse 12 to 18. So I don't know, does anyone have anything to say concerning this verse about Isaac? The focus basically on Isaac is how he goes economically. You know, so this obviously we are getting into the meat, the juicy parts, you know, that hits the nail on the head. So this is where the rubber hits the road. So does anyone have anything to share from verse 12 to 18, please? Now I'm beginning to feel what John felt in the book of Revelation. He said there was silence in heaven for like, was it 30 minutes or 30 seconds? And I wept and I wept and I wept. And an angel appeared to me saying, "Why do you weep?" So does anyone or no one has anything to say on this verse? Doesn't speak to us in any way? Okay, Abosede Akinleye. The reward of obedience is powerful. If we can live in obedience, we will see more of God. So good. Very good. Very, very good. Anyone else? Does anyone have anything to share? Brother Folu? The power of sowing seed. Okay. Brother Folu, please, can you explain the power of sowing seed, please?
Thank you so much, sir. It's so awesome.
Very good, sir.
Don't follow them, sir. Don't mind them, sir. We use it a lot
to encourage people in the area of sowing seed. Sorry, can you hear me, sir?
Loud and clear.
All right. we use it a lot to encourage people in the area of sowing seed and stuff like that. It's just quite powerful when you just read, especially the verse 12, sowing seed in a land where there's all kinds of stuff going on. And it didn't actually say anything about him having it in a very long space of time, but it says he received something back in that same year. And it says that the Lord bless him. So that was why I just put the comment, the power of sowing seed. The power of sowing seed, it can be sowing seeds in a strategic manner. And sometimes really, let me just throw this in. Sometimes, most time, seed doesn't always have to be, sometimes we think money. There's a place in the scripture that says the seed is the word of God, in somewhere in the book of Luke. So sometimes sowing can just be a form of you are led by the Spirit to put something into the ground. A husband is married to the wife, and actually he is also is a sower. He can also sow in the land of famine. Maybe the woman is barren or whatever, but he can sow a seed into her, and in that same year he can get a hundredfold in the form of a child. Thank you, sir.
That was awesome. Like Sensei, that was awesome. Like what really got me there was that a seed doesn't always have to be money. You know, and I just look at Isaac sowed in the land, and in the same year he reaped a hundredfold. And you know, just relating it, I think what you're trying to cross reference was the parable of the sower. Where the sower, then where Jesus is giving a parable in, I think he gives in each of the gospel except that of John, you know, and it falls on good soil. And in that same season where some are eating up, some dry up, some are unproductive, this one goes a hundredfold. And the primary seed is the word of God. I think that is very, very, very important. I think that is a higher level of understanding. Thank you, God, for what's to put it. What am I trying to say? Like, Isaac also is because God told him something, that stay in this land, I'll bless you in this land. So God sowed a word into Isaac's heart. So before Isaac, thank you, Holy Spirit. Before Isaac received a hundredfold harvest, the word in his heart also received a hundredfold harvest. I believe both of them were happening side by side. Like, as God spoke that word to Isaac, stay in this land, you prosper in this land. And Isaac meditated on that word, kept the word in his heart. You know, because if you read Genesis 25, you know that Isaac was prone to meditation, you know. And as he prospered in his heart, I believe it also ensured that what he planted also prospered. I believe the miracle first happened internally. Because when the word God speaks come, when God speaks a word, the aim of the word is to first change us before it changes our external environment. You know, you see the book of Proverbs, it will tell you that a man who conquers himself is better than a man who conquers a city. You know, so God is more interested in the soul of a man than even in the external, manifestations. You know, so the word actually prospered in Isaac. You know, so good. So good, so good, please. That really blessed me. Thank you for sharing. Please, any of you guys that's holding revelation like this and you don't want to share, you are being stingy or so word into my life or into everybody's life, please, it really benefits all of us. Another thing I want to also share, just to mention, is, someone was taking this verse, you know, and just like Brother Folu said, I've always heard this verse when it was like, oh, sow a seed in terms of tithing, in terms of first fruits and everything, which we all know. I think all of us know that God loves a cheerful giver whose delight is in his giving. But the person said that actually, Isaac did not give sacrificially. Isaac did not carry his seed and go and give Melchizedek. What Isaac did was he invested in business. Isaac did business. And then it just made sense. Because even if you read other translations, the Bible, it will say Isaac planted in the land. You know, I think some of us just carried that sword around with it, you know. But like, how can we relate it with our modern day terms? An industry that has fascinated me has been the Bitcoin industry or the crypto industry. Because like, man, like you can really see this literally. Like you show in that land and reap 100-fold. Like you bought this coin and this coin is now... You bought this coin at $1, now it's $500. Like, that really happens at every day. But, like, Isaac invested in the economy. And in that same year, his investment reaped a hundredfold based on obedience. Like, that's just mind-blowing, you know. And, you know, Isaac was swimming against the current, because in famine, that's not the right time. Like, there are various sectors to invest your money in, you know, and they're telling you to invest in the agri sector, where you're not sure if you put the effort in plowing the ground, in digging the ground, in planting the seed. You're not sure if that effort will yield manpower. I'm sure you have to hire people to help you do all those things, you know. And you still choose to sow in the land of famine, in the land of scarcity. You know, it takes real faith to obey in that period. You know, Isaac, my God, just bless me with livestock. Let me just be walking on the road and I'll just see 100 cows that'll make me survive this period. But God said, no, go back to farming. Like, where others are saying there's a casting down, for you, Isaac, there'll be lifting up. You know, everybody's experiencing farming. Everybody's saying, man, agri is not the business to go into. But in this same year, Isaac going to agri, and we see that year he reaped a hundredfold just by simple obedience. You know, God is also interested in our businesses. God is interested in our financial life. God actually wants us to prosper. And we can see clearly from the life of Isaac, you know. So we see that this is the beginning, or this is the disobedience actually opens the door to Isaac prospering. We see that he has flocks, herds, and something happens as he's prospering. Envy starts. People start to envy him. And that's one thing I realized, that favor attracts envy. Favor attracts envy. There's a scripture in the book of Proverbs, Proverbs 29, verse 25. I quoted it before, that the fear of man is a snare. You know, that's why God wants us to be resolute, not to be afraid of men, you know, because when God is saying that I'm favoring you, like, the other equation is that people begin to envy you, or you attract people that will attack you, just like Joseph, you know. God blessed him with so much favor, and his brothers envied him and they started attacking him, you know. And, you know, that's why Jesus in the Beatitudes, it changes our mentality of what we see the blessing as. You know, he says, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And everyone says, blessed are you when men despise you, when men curse you, blessed are you. I'm blessed when people are hating you. And God is like, I'm with you, bro. Like, it's because I'm with you. Like, the reason why they are punishing you is because I'm with you. You know, and the instruction to them is that rejoice when this is happening. I can see it well in the life of the apostles, that when they go through all the circumstances of people hating on them, like, they rejoice in that circumstance. Yes, thank you so much. But whosoever putteth his trust in the Lord will receive. Now, another thing we see in Genesis chapter 26, verse 18, is that Isaac is not only blessed as he's planting seed in the ground. Isaac is blessed while he's digging for wells. Now, let's think about this. What causes famine? Scarcity of food. What causes scarcity of food? Scarcity of water. You know, that's why there was famine in the land. But it's like everything is clicking for Isaac. Like, where other people's crops are not growing, his crops are growing. And Baba is now finding wells everywhere. You know, I'm sure there are plenty of wells in the area. That's why the Philistines covered up the well of Abraham. Because at that time, there was no famine. So they covered up Abraham's well, you know, because all their wells were prospering. So probably, I'm just insinuating, you know. But, like, so they covered it up. But now Isaac is going back to the wells of his father, and he's redigging them, and he's also seeing water. Like, this is amazing. Like, everything is working for him, you know. But the first thing is, when did this start? This started from God blessing him with his presence. This started from God blessing him with his presence. Very, very critical. So can someone quickly read from verse 19 to from 19 to 25. Can someone read from 19 to 25 quickly? I want us to finish in good timing.
Okay, I'll read. Can I hear?
Yes, loud and clear now.
Okay. 1925, Isaac's servants also dug in the Jera Valley and discovered a well of fresh water. But then the shepherd from Jera came and claimed the spring. "This is our water," they said, and they argued over it with Isaac's herdsmen. So Isaac named the well Issac, which means argument. Isaac's men then dug another well, but again, there was a dispute over it. So Isaac named it Sitna, which means hostility. Abandoning that one, Isaac moved on and dug another one. This time, there was no dispute over it. So Isaac named the place Rehoboth, which means open space, for he said, "At last, the Lord has created enough space for us to prosper in this land." From there, Isaac moved to Beersheba, where the Lord appeared to him on the night of his arrival. "I am the God of your father, Abraham," he said. "Do not be afraid, for I am with you, and we bless you. I'll multiply your descendants, and you'll become, and you'll become a great nation. I'll do this because of my promise to Abraham, my servant." Then Isaac built an altar there and worshiped the Lord. He set up his camp at that space, place, and his servant dug another well.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that. Sister Bosse, did you have anything to share about what you just read, please? Or does anyone have anything to share? I have a question, basically. And now I was thinking about this question before I got on this call. We'll be glad if anyone has an answer to that. The question is this. We see that Isaac plants, they fight him, he leaves. They fight him, he leaves. And he goes until they don't fight him again. So the question I ask myself is, but sometimes I know we need to contend for certain locations. So why, when do we think that it's a right decision? Like, do you think Isaac was right to leave those wells till he got, do you think it was the right strategy? Or like to leave those wells till you get to a place of peace? Or do you think Isaac should have fought for those wells? That's the first question I have. Then the second question is, like, I know it is right to fight sometimes. Where is the wisdom to know when it is right to fight over a particular inheritance God has given you? Or it's time to leave it, you know, like, it's temp. I don't know. So I don't know if anyone has an answer to that question. So I'm trying that out up there. Because I think that's one thing I'm noticing from the work of Isaac, that he's just leaving things until he gets to a place of peace and he rests there. But I know that sometimes we are called to fight. So how do you know the difference? So. Okay, Brafu, please, can you, you're free to speak, please.
Thank you so much. Let me put my yellow hand down. It's really, really a good one. It's really a good one. I think, you know, now, I know that there could be many answers to that question you raised, sir. For me, I think, when you find a person doing a certain thing, you know, keeps going at something, and then all of a sudden, the thing now changes at the last instance. I perceive, especially when it's now documented in scripture, I perceive that it is the Lord working on the inside of that person for a particular purpose at the end of that which now manifests. The reason I'm saying that is I'm thinking about somebody like Elijah as well, saying, "Go to this place, you will find something. There's a cloud or something." I can't remember that scripture. And it's, that one comes back and says, "There's nothing." He said, go again. I perceive sometimes when God is doing a working on the inside of person, sometimes they don't even know what they're doing. That's if you are led by the Spirit. You may not even know why am I continuing to do this? The reason I'm saying that is one can try to fight in the flesh and maybe sometimes get it. But the reason why it's been documented here, I perceive that these people must have had a strong, they didn't even know what they were doing. Keep going at it. Scripture says that the word of God is like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. I'm paraphrasing. So I just perceived that, you know, and the scripture says that in him we live, we move. Sometimes we move and we don't really know where we're moving to. We just know something is just causing us to do what we do. So I don't know. I hope I made small sense. Thank you, sir.
Yes. I picked a few things that sometimes there's something on the inside that is quickening the movement. I don't know if I'm quoting you well. Like there's something speaking on the inside that was
compelling. Yes, that's it.
Yes, to persist. I don't know if I'm coaching you well. Did I coach you well, sir?
Okay. Absolutely, sir. That's it, sir.
Okay. So I'm going to read Sister Wumi's contribution. Honestly, I don't know about the answer to the question in regards to if Isaac should have stayed. However, what I see was that God was with him regardless of where he went. Similar to Abraham, where he told Lot, pick whatever space you want, and I'll take the opposite. And the Lord blessed wherever they went. Very cool. Like, Lord blessed wherever they went. Sister Abosede said, Isaac was a man of peace. Secondly, he was not by his effort, but that everything he lays his hand on will be blessed. So he will not fret. It's true. That's exactly the promise God gave to Abraham and now to Isaac. So everything he lays his hand on. So the blessing is in Isaac, not in those wells and everything, you know. Same with us. The economy of this world cannot determine our blessings. We carry God's presence and his presence. That is the blessing. Amen. Isaac was walking along with the promise of God for him. So Isaac was believing now. He was moving in faith. Like, okay, I am the blessing. God has promised to bless me. If you take this well is not my blessing. On to the next one. Everywhere I go, the blessing will follow me. Very, very cool. You know, there's a scripture that comes to mind in Psalm 84. It says, Psalm 84. It says, from verse 4. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They'll still be praising you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. The emphasis is on verse 6. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with food. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. So like these people whose hearts are set on pilgrimage, they are going through a valley and they are making it a spring. The presence of God that is with them, you know, is causing things to happen. You know, it also makes me remember Psalm 114. You know, it talks about when God made, I don't know how to quote that scripture verbatim, but it's just talking about the effect of the presence of God on the journey. Yes, I like the book of Psalms. Yes, it's good. Psalm 114, it talks about when God makes Judah a sanctuary, when God makes Israel his habitation, how these miraculous things are happening because of the presence of God. So I think that's very, wow, that was so awesome, guys. Thank you so much for that. You know, but another question I wanted to ask, someone mentioned Lot. So Abraham, why didn't Abraham leave Lot and say, as Abraham also, you know, they contended with some wells with Abraham and Abraham left them. Like, why didn't Abraham also leave Lot? Why did Abraham decide to fight? So when would you decide to fight? Like, I'm asking a question. What wisdom will you know that, okay, this is, Lot wants this land, so he can choose whatever land he wants. But I'm not going to leave the five nations to take Lot. I'm going to fight until I get him. So when do you know when to fight and when to leave? So I just want to ask, does anyone have a practical wisdom application on situations where you're meant to fight for this promise, you're meant to contend a fight of faith, or when you're just meant to, you know what, the blessing is in me, I'm not going to fight over this. So does anyone have an answer to that? And as we are loading to the answer to the, okay, Sister Wumi, be led by the Spirit. I like that, be led by the Spirit. Sometimes it's the easiest answer to all questions. You don't ask many questions. The Holy Spirit will lead you. That is as sweet, and it's not Elijah. It's a sure banker. Don't ask me. The Spirit will tell you. The Spirit will show you. Sister Bosse, basically by God's instructions. basically by God's instruction. Okay, thank you so much. We are having the same number of people contributing, and that's amazing, but we're going to call on others to contribute, please. So we're going to start from, we stopped at verse 25, I think. No. Stopped at verse what? Okay, yes, Rehoboth. Rehoboth. Yes, we stopped at verse 25. Okay, one point I'm going to mention that I note there is in verse 23. He got to verse 22 says he got to Rehoboth and he proclaimed something about it. One thing that I see Isaac that is doing, which I don't think is a New Testament reality, is Isaac is naming places based on what happens in that situation. So we see he calls a valley a well Esek because of contention. He calls another well Sitna because of quarrels there. And you know, basically that's what they used to name people in those days, situations and things. You were used to name a lot of people and things, you know. Like when someone was born, when Israel lost the battle, they called him Ichabod, meaning the glory of God has departed from a child. I'm sure that's not what God named that child at the beginning. You know, you have situations where someone is going through sorrow and she calls her son Jabez. So naming is very important. So I think they did this a lot in the Old Testament, but I don't think this is a New Testament reality. You know, faith is calls those things that are not as though they were. You know, Abraham never called himself, did not call himself, God had to change his name from Abraham to Abraham. So I don't think it's a New Testament reality. I don't recommend us calling situations as they are. I recommend that we call situations based on what God is saying about the situation, not based on the experience, you know. So finally, Isaac calls this place Rehoboth and he goes to Beersheba. Now, I just want to talk a bit about Beersheba. You know, the Bible says he went from there to Beersheba and the Lord appeared to him the same night. So as Isaac entered Beersheba, that same night God appeared to him. Now, this is a cause and effect. The writer is trying to make you understand something. Isaac is entering Beersheba. He doesn't do anything in Beersheba and God meets him in Beersheba. You know, and when you, now, why is this very important? If you look at those days, there were areas that were portals into heavenly realities. If you look at the story of Jacob, where Jacob goes and lays his head and sleeps in a place and sees angels ascending and descending and calls the name of the place Bethel. Those stones he saw there were not coincidence. Abraham had journeyed to that location before. And Abraham sought God in that location. You can check that place in Genesis chapter 12. Also, this place that God appeared before Isaac is not also coincidental. If you check Genesis chapter 21, if you have time, read Genesis chapter 21. The Bible says that Abraham sought God in that location and there he met God called El Olam, which means the everlasting God. So Isaac is walking into spiritual heritage. Isaac is like Abraham really did a good relay race, you know. And you see, some of us, when we say things like that, we're like, my father was a Babalawo, my mother was a Babalawo and everything. But we are not looking at it right scripturally, because in Hebrews chapter 11, it tells us we too, we have a spiritual heritage. Abraham is my father. And it shows me the hall of faith of people that have set a good pace before me. That means they have laid a foundation block for me, you know, that I can run on. Just talk to mention that how Abraham intentionally, his works are helping Isaac. So because of time, I'm going to quickly read from 26 to 33. And we talk on it, then we round up quickly. You know, then Abimelech came to him from Gerar with Ahuzah, one of his friends, and Phicol, the commander of his army. And Isaac said to them, "Why have you come to me since you hate me and you have sent me away from you?" But they said, "We have certainly seen that the Lord is with you. So we said, let that there now be an oath between us and between you and us. Let us make a covenant with you that you do us no harm since we have not touched you. And since we have not done, since we have done nothing to you but good and sent you away with peace, you are now the blessed of the Lord. So he made them a feast. They ate and drank. Then they rose early in the morning and swore an oath with one another. And Isaac sent them away, and they departed from him in peace. And it came to pass that same day, Isaac's servants came and told him about the well they had dug, and said to him, "We have found water." Now this is a period of famine, and Isaac is finding water like no man's business. But I can tell you that Isaac is not finding water coincidentally. There is divine logic at work. We can see number one, Isaac went to dig the well of the fathers. That is very, 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 very important to note. He's walking a path. He's not fighting blindly or aimlessly. He first went to dig the well of the waters. You even see some places where he calls on God before he digs a well in that place. Now, and now it is telling you now that, now the point I want to make is that, why is it that after it came to pass that that same day, Isaac's servants came and told him about the well they had dug and said to him, "We have found water." Why is it that it was after the visitation of these people and after Isaac agreed to be made to be at peace with them, agreed to forgive them, agreed not to hold any ill feelings or ill thought against them, that he found water? How come? And you see, in the scriptures, water is significant because it's metaphorical to the presence of the Holy Spirit. You know, it is metaphorical to the presence of the Spirit. That's why Jesus would tell the woman at the well that your fathers drank this water, now they are dead. I have the water. If you drink, you never thirst again. So water sometimes is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit dwells in areas of peace. Below, behold how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. The Holy Spirit dwells in an area where there is where there is an atmosphere of love, of peace, of joy. You know, the Bible says in James, it says, where there is strife and envy, there abounds every evil work. You know, so I don't think it's a coincidence that after Isaac comes into peace with these people that are hurt him and he forgives them, that he finds water. I feel this is a link to his prosperity. And I feel if we critically look at these scriptures, we can find scriptural, we can find ways to connect this with New Testament realities. So I think that's all from me. Another thing to note is that Isaac, like now, Isaac knew he was blessed of the Lord. But by believing that word consistently, now everybody now knows that he's blessed of the Lord. You know, even the Philistines that hated him, they said, "Certainly, we now know that God is with you." I know the Bible says, if a man's ways pleases the Lord, God will even cause his enemies to be at peace with him. You know, that I think that's a very, very crucial line. You know, the Bible says the fear of man is a snare. So when we say be at peace with everybody, it's not being a people pleaser. The way to be at peace with everyone is first to be a God pleaser. By pleasing God, you'll be at peace with everyone because even your enemies will be at peace with you. So you see, the way Isaac achieves peace with all men, with these people, is by consistently following the tenets of God, which causes the enemies around him to be at peace with him, not by being a people pleaser. You know, I just thought to mention that. So I think I'm going to leave that open. Does anyone have anything to share? Any addition, subtraction, question, answers, insights? The floor is yours, please. Okay, Adebisi, any comment? Adeonke, any comment? Elizabeth, any comment? Timtop, any comment? Amaka, any comment? Anything you've learned, anything you want to share? Please, the floor is open. Okay, Okay. If there's no comment, I'll just say, okay. Adrian, okay. You're muted. I muted.
yes. What something that just came to my mind? The question you asked before, that why did Isaac know what to do, when to be angry with people, when not to know to be angry with them, and what you just said, that Isaac was a God pleaser, not a people's pleaser. So because he was a God pleaser, he knew when to get angry and when to want to get angry. And what just came to my mind was about Jesus in the New Testament. He knew when to get angry and when not to get angry. Like, there are so many examples that we would have thought that we would be angry with the Pharisees, but he had the answers to answer to them. So, and then he knew when to get angry, that when he went into the temple and he was angry. So that was just what came to my mind.
Wow. Very powerful. Thank you so much for that. Actually very powerful. By choosing to please God, he knew when to be angry and when not to be angry. Very, very interesting. Very, actually, thank you so much for that. So we'll have closed without you sharing this one with us. That would have been fair. Okay, Sister Elizabeth, do you have anything to say? Sister Debisi, someone here is still with my dodo. You know, I started this with, I said, someone has my dodo here. Or someone is holding our dodo. So who is holding our dodo? I'm sure the Holy Spirit is not doing small, say, still say it. I know they are past that topic, but still go back and say it. Please say it before we end. We've actually, there's nothing, we've covered the scripture actually. So, but if anyone has anything to share, anything you feel that God laid in your heart that can bless us, please, the floor is open, please share. Okay. Okay. In the absence of no one to share, we'll just end with prayer. And thank you guys for staying on. I've been blessed, and I'm sure we have also been blessed. And I know God will continue to expand my understanding as we catch the fire this season in the mighty name of Jesus. One thing that also stuck out to me when I was thinking about it is on when to fight and when not to fight. I see consistency with Abraham fighting for Lot, not out of his selfish ambition, but the need to fight for his brother who is in a less privileged position, you know. And I see Jesus also doing that, standing up for the oppressed. If you call Jesus a bastard, he won't do anything. The Pharisees called him that, he didn't do anything. If you abuse Jesus personally, if you say he does things by the devil, he will just answer you calmly. But when you started affecting those around him, when you do the widows, the poor, the woman that her back is bent for some number of years, and the Pharisees are telling him that it's a Sabbath day, Jesus got very angry in situations like this, in defending his brother. So you see that his love led him to fight for his brother. Same thing with Abraham. You see that Abraham is ready to fight for the soul of Lot, even in that situation. So I think God is calling us to a place where we fight for what is truly eternal. And what is truly eternal is the soul of men. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and to lose his soul? Abraham knew that, Isaac knew that the blessing was in him. The blessing was in him, you know, but the soul is eternal. And God is so critical about the soul investment and is willing to fight for it. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Auntie Phillips, please, you can talk. You can
unmute. Hi, hello, everyone. Yeah, so there's this part about reading in the world where is there they're talking about water, looking for water and all, but then it's just the same thing as when we go through spiritual famine, when you feel like you can't hear from God, when everything is dried up, you feel like nothing else is happening. So it's just like this verse is a constant reminder that you have to go back. I remember the promise God made to Abraham and redeem those wells spiritually. You pray. Prayers don't get, it's not every time you pray and then, you know, you get the response immediately. So what Isaac did was, he did it the first time, second time, third time, the fourth time. And that's the consistency in it till you get the answer you are looking for. And I noticed that Isaac was not he was not doing it just, let me do this thing. But I remember that he has this kind of promise that God has given to his father, and which God has remembered him also. And he knows that there's a path already made for me to walk in, which is the right path, which I won't miss my way. He started walking in that path, and he made sure that his eyes was all set on God. It's as if he tied God's clothes to his own clothes to lead him. And it was as if he was God's mind reader. Like, the thought of God is the kind of thought I'm going to have within me. And that's just, I don't know. I think that's the best way I can articulate what I've learned from this Bible lesson. Yeah, that's all.
Thank you so much, Sister Elizabeth. Now I have my dodo. I knew someone was holding my dodo before. If anyone is holding my moi moi and my coleslaw, please release it now. But thank you so much. That was truly amazing. That Isaac was warring with the promise that he received from his father Abraham, from God, that was given to his father Abraham. And that when we are low spiritually, we should go back to those promises, remind ourselves of it constantly until it resonates with us. I think that was very, very powerful, very, very powerful. The image that came to my mind as you're saying this was when Paul was telling Timothy that remember the prophecies that were spoken concerning you and war with those prophecies, just like Isaac used those prophecies to war. So thank you so, so much. Thank you so, so much. Really appreciate. So I'm just going to...
I think I have your moi moi.
Thank you. Sister Martha, I know someone had moi moi, okay. Well, please give us the moi moi.
No, you know, Sister Elizabeth was like someone, you know when you go to a party and somebody wants to pass the dessert, the ice cream, and you're like, no, I think I want this. But you say, taste the ice cream. The ice cream is better. That's what happened to me. I've been going back to, my mind has just been going back to, you know, 18, when he says that, and I think he opened the well that had been dug in the time of his father Abraham, which the Philistines had stopped up after Abraham died, and he gave them the same name his father had given them. You know, my mind had just been, every time, I remember you saying that there's somebody holding on to something, and, you know, I was just like, I don't know what is coming up to me in this scripture, but my mind has just been going back to it. And Elizabeth just gave me the passage, as in, go back and we dig the well, as in, go back and listen to testimony. There are times that you don't feel up to it, and you just don't know what to do next. As you just go back to that thing that your first love, that thing that, you know, that can easily connect us to God, as in, is it testimony, is it, you know? And you know when Ina says that even Abraham, Isaac's father, as in Abraham, was one that dug the world, and I'm like, there's something that, you know, when I just thought about the things that my father had done, and, you know, leaving his mark somewhere, and you go there and they say, oh, this is what your father had done and all. I think so. I'm just connecting all the dots, like what you do last long. I think whatever testimony you have, just keep on saying it, because, you know, you don't know who might need it, and maybe somebody in your family would remember that oh, my father did this, and the testimony will be, you know, we encourage that child at all. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so, so much. Go back to the testimonies. Remind yourself constantly of God's faithfulness. Remind yourself constantly of God's faithfulness. Very, 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 very key. Most importantly, we have a spiritual heritage. You see, this also helps with people that, you know, your dad was a Babalawo, your grandfather was a Babalawo, your mom was a witch, your grandmother was a witch. You know, what will now happen to them? You know, you claim your spiritual heritage. You are Abraham's seed. And Abraham, there is through Christ. The Bible says the promise was made to Abraham and to his seed and to his heir, to his seed. And that was to seed, not seeds, and that seed's in Christ. So by Christ, we have all the promises of Abraham. By Christ, what Abraham has done, we have access to it. We have access to it, you know. So please cling on to your spiritual heritage. Walk through the paths your fathers have walked, you know, and you obtain victory. You know, you know, like, just to say this one point, like, you see the story of Gideon. He walked with testimonies and prophecies. We know that Gideon took 300 people to fight an army. But how did he know that 300 people could fight an army? Yes, God told him school. But in scriptures, his father also took 318 men, Abraham, and he defeated the whole five kings, you know. So testimonies have a way of replicating and repeating themselves. So thank you so, so much for that. If there's no other contribution, we're just going to end with prayer. I'm just going to count 5 more seconds. If anyone still has the coleslaw or mocktail or cocktail, they can give us. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. So thank you everyone for being on this call. So thank you, Father Abba. The Bible says in the book of Job that you are Yahweh who teaches like you. Thank you, Abba, because you are a teacher. And there is no teacher that rivals you. Why? Because you can teach even the simplest person understanding. The Bible says something that even gives you joy is that you choose to, you said that you choose to reveal your secrets to babes. You choose to pass on the wise men, the people that feel they are wise in their own wisdom, and look for those that don't know anything to teach them their way. The Bible says that God instructs sinners in their ways of righteousness so he can show forth his majestic presence. Thank you, Father, because you're an awesome teacher. Thank you, Father, because your word brings understanding and clarity to the simple. Thank you, Father, because, you know, we boast about teachers that are able to teach people with dyslexia, attention deficit disorder, but you teach even the lowliest of all. Thank you, Father, because you are the one that teaches our fingers to walk, and you teach our hands to do warfare. Thank you, Father, because you are a teacher. Thank you, Father, because our boast is that there is no one you cannot help. Our boast is that there is no one that you cannot save. Our boast is that there is no sinner that you cannot teach righteousness. And Lord, our boast is in you. Father, we decree a heightened level of understanding to everyone on this call, O Lord. We decree dream encounters in the mighty name of Jesus. We have just heard about the heroes of faith. Isaac stepped into the land of Beersheba, and immediately you met him that night. Now, in Christ is the place of our encounter. The Bible says, upon the Son of Man, you see angels ascending and descending. So we, that Christ dwells in us, we are open portals to spiritual realities. I decree, O Lord, that all our dreams this night are blessed in the mighty name of Jesus. I decree there's an opening into diverse manifestations of the supernatural in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we just heard about our hero of faith, Isaac, how you prospered him economically and financially. I decree upon us that we are not just readers, but this thing will have effect in our life. I decree that our economic situation changes in the name of Jesus. And I decree that there is power to obey. There is a grace for obedience that comes from you. The Bible says, a hearing ear and a seeing eye come from the Lord. I decree that our ears are ears that see. Our eyes are eyes that see, and our hearts are those that understand your precepts and that can walk in your way. Thank you, Father, because our boast is that the Lord has led us. Our boast is that the Lord is our shepherd. Our boast is that we are a people helped by God. Thank you, Lord, because we know that you've heard us. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. So have a lovely night, everyone. God bless us. Thank you for joining. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister Emmanuel. God bless you. Thank you for blessing us today.
Thank God for blessing. I'm happy to be a channel. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you. God bless everyone. Bye. Thank you, everyone that contributed, and those that contributed in your heart. I know you contribute in your heart, you start contributing. So someone has even apostled me. Thank you. Thank you also. So to some of us that didn't talk, maybe your goodbyes, you can say goodbye to us. But I think everyone on this call talked. Everyone present here actually said so. So thank you for contributing.
All right. See you on Monday. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.